So we're going to wrap this up. We're going to finish by going over our quarter inch stamp overlay. The system is called Stamp It. You can find the spec sheet and all the information right on our website, right where Mallory had that video showing you. And this is a great option for doing something decorative over a concrete substrate. So we've covered the concrete preparation, but a lot of times it's the condition of the concrete. And I don't know if I've covered that as of yet. The concrete can't be feeble. It can't be breaking apart. It can't be degrading to a point where, hey, a coating is gonna, you know, hold it all together. It's like, you know, a fence full of termites falling over. New coat of paint is not gonna help much. It might look good for a little short period, but it's still gonna fall over. So evaluation is one thing, and you can always reach out to, you know, your rep, whoever, you know, handles your particular area, and speak to them. Not so much about exact application. That might be an arena that you know, but it's more of what to look for, where the products are used, the arena that they fit in. And now that's what we do is provide that experience. So we're going to step right into this. Now, one thing I mentioned at the beginning of this demo is priming concrete. And we showed taking our WP81 and diluting with 4 parts water and using it as a primer. I also spoke to the EC11 water-based epoxy as a more industrious primer, beefier way of priming concrete. And some of the benefits to that are that it holds aggregate. And so we're able to seed it with aggregate as we prime. And it does better with, you know, subtle amounts of moisture in the concrete. If you can remember the pie chart that Mallory put up, outside of just lack or poor preparation, moisture was the second most common issue for coatings having problems, issues, challenges, and desponding. Failing, dare I say failing, allegedly failing. So Mike is going to mix up the EC11. Which is a water-based epoxy. It's a two component. We have what color, Mike? Cape Cod gray. Two parts A, one part B. Again, Surrey, set timer for 3 minutes. Make no mistake that this two component products need to be accurately timed. Get all the contents out of the pail, the bucket, the measuring unit that you're using. In this case, that's what we're doing because we're mixing a partial mix. Slow RPM mixer. Do not whip a bunch of air into the product. While Mike is mixing that, I'm gonna step in front of the camera here. Right here, stamp overlay. So this is one of the samples we have in our showroom. Quarter inch overlay. And I'm going to speak to if you have areas that are low or that need to be sloped or built up. This product, the TC6, is a 50-pound bag of dry polymer cement. And this product can be built up a little bit. So you can fudge the thickness from a quarter of an inch to something a little bit thicker. I typically wouldn't recommend going thicker with this product than a half of an inch because it changes the dry times. And I've done this on jobs where I had low areas of joints, and as I was gauge raking out the stamp mix itself, I went heavier in a low spot. And it caught me off guard because then it didn't dry at the same pace as the rest of the surface. And so as I was laying out stamp on stamp on stamp, I hit the area that was a half inch thick and it was still very wet underneath the surface. And some of the problems with stamping too early is you put footprints in the surface. And so that's kind of a no-no, it's, you know, especially when you stand it, you start seeing it. So if you have sloping or buildup to do, you do it prior to the stamp overlay, and you can feather your edges. Now, it's all Westcoat products. Again, don't go somewhere else and look for different products. Keep it in the family. So we're almost there. I can see his clock, 2 minutes and 51 seconds. And 3 minutes. Excellent. Okay, so now we have properly mixed EC11, water-based epoxy. The product is incredibly user-friendly. It is very different from 100% solids epoxy. So it's going to roll down thin. It's a gallon and a half kit. On a surface like properly profiled concrete, you're going to get 250 to 300 square feet per gallon. So almost 450 square feet a kit, right? And you need to broadcast sand in it as you go. Okay? We have sand? There's sand? So this is a big bucket of sand. I would recommend a smaller bucket. I'm getting old. So broadcasting sand. So this needs to be done rapidly when you're outside. And you're just, you're broadcasting sand, you're covering the epoxy. I would essentially say to the point of refusal. It doesn't need to be to the point of refusal like we're doing a double broadcast epoxy floor system or a quartz floor system, but you want to make sure that you cover all the epoxy. So I think the spec says, you know, lightly broadcast sand on the epoxy. I would go a little heavier than lightly. Make sure that there's no smooth epoxy on the surface. And so, yeah, this is, I kind of refer to this as chicken feeding the broadcast material. So it's a nice product. It'll dry in typically 2 to 4 hours, sometimes faster than that. You clean off any excess sand. You just broom it and blow it off. Clean out your joints. Remember, in a stamp overlay, we are going to honor expansion joints. So if there's an expansion joint going right through this thing, we will apply the EC11 down to the joint. Take a brush and brush it out. So you're pulling the product out. So it's coated down into the joint, but you don't want to try and bridge this with any aspect of the system. So once that is dry, you can then move to a finished primed board. And this is a finished prime board. This is EC11 with a sand broadcast on it, and it's very, very grippy and very gritty. There are other overlay stamp overlay systems on the market that I've personally used for years, and they're always somewhat frustrating. I'm gonna move on you, Victoria. They're frustrating because it was kind of a wet on wet on wet application. And anybody that's done stamp overlays, they might be very familiar with this. When you're actually working and walking in a wet bond cement type product, this was always frustrating. So thus the water-based epoxy is, number one, there's no smell to it. And number two, it dries very, very fast. And now we have this grit surface that there will be absolutely zero question if we will bond with a thicker cement, because that's what we're going to put down. In this case, it's a quarter of an inch overlay. And that's honestly the stamp overlay, the TC6, 50-pound bag, TC6. That performs best at 1/4 inch. So we are going to bring over everything we need. Mike's grabbing the stamp here. We have broomed off our primer. Typically, it's next day. We'll do all of our preparation and get our EC11 down and throw the sand in there and then go home. Come back the next day, clean up my sand and get everything laid out. And this is something, just another pro tip, is orchestrate how you're going to do this job. You must pay attention to what's in the shade, what's in the sun. The product in the sun is going to be ready to stamp faster than the product in the shade. So it can be challenging sometimes. So starting points, mixing stations, where do I keep my tools, my stamps, my release, my trowels that I would always have with me to fix my edges. They all need to be appropriately placed. So you got to think about this when you're starting to lay out your stamp. So lay out your stamps in the area that you're first going to start stamping. And then once you're on the surface, really need to follow the pattern that you laid out the product, right? Paying attention to what might be in the sun. On windy days, pay attention to the edges. You might want to have a skin and be able to texture your edges. If there's a breeze coming in there, you need to figure out, you know what, I need to pay attention to that edge. It's going to dry faster. So you got to pay attention to your environment. That's really my point here. Okay, so Mike is ready to make a stamp overlay mix. We are, this just gets mixed with water, okay? This is no more than 5 quarts of water. That's too soupy, too runny. So I believe spec sheet calls for 4 to 5 quarts of water. Now, one of the ways to retard this product is use ice water or cold water. We've done that in hot environments. And be cautious. I was talking to Mike during the break about using accelerator. I mentioned you can use accelerator with all our cements. And it's really not a good idea because it can cure too fast and cause some fracturing, breaking, or cracking. So don't use accelerator in the TC6 cement. So 50-pound bag of TC6, you put the water in the bucket, 4 to 5 quarts of water. And now Mike's going to put in the liquid colorant. What color you got, Mike?
Cinnamon.
Cinnamon, how much?
1 ounce.
1 ounce. So 1 ounce of cinnamon in the 5 quarts of water. And you can see what he's doing to get the pigment, if you can. He's actually got one of the little pump-up sprayers to mist out that little medicine cup with color. So Mike is going to mix this up. It is a 50-pound bag of TC6 cement. Using the same cage bit. And you can see he just doesn't dump the whole thing in there, splish, splash. He's careful about it. And usually it's not a one-man show. Usually you'll have a guy mixing it while he's pouring in to the pail. So you got a guy on drill or a woman on drill, and the bag is being slowly put into the product. And it works very well as far as how fast and how consistent the mix will come together. All right. Rinse the drill. We got a good consistency. Again, you've heard me say it a few times. Pancake batter consistency, meaning it needs to be pourable. Mix stations should be really pretty close to where you're going to be working. You don't want to have to carry full 5 gallon pails a long way to your surface. Now, the other thing is it's going down much thicker. Your yield is about 25 square feet per batch. So 25 square feet is going to be applied very fast. Mike, hold that rake up for a sec. This is a gauge rake, and it's measured with these star wings right here. For a quarter of an inch. Actually, if you measure it when it's brand new, it's probably just beyond a quarter of an inch because as you pull the product, it comes in just shy of that. So we want a quarter of an inch. And I would usually have small margin trowels, let me get out of the way here, for up against walls. And you would leave a bead at the edge and you would come in here and just finish your edge with a trowel. Now, I've seen concrete finishers working with stamp overlay. And what they try and do is they try and put a nice finish on this surface. The thing about this is, remember, we're going to completely emboss this. We don't need a nice finish on this surface. We just need it in place. We just need it at 1/4 inch. And yes, that means 1/4 inch everywhere. Up against the wall, at every joint, it's real easy to lose the side of the gauge rake down into a joint. Be cautious of that. If there's low spots in the surface, make sure your gauge rake is going the right direction. It'll be frustrating when you try and stamp the surface when it's stampable and there's no depth to it because there was a high point and you had your gauge rake on both sides of this high point, right? So if you got all these things, it's the observation of your canvas prior to doing the job. Make notes of everything. We used to write everything down. Thank you, Mike. We used to write everything down so that as a sales aspect of the project, the guys in the field knew what I was talking about. And now you're able to do that with photos, pictures, video. Say, hey, you know, this wall to deck junction, you know, this step, we're going vertical on this step. We're going over this cantilever edge on the pool deck. Everything needs to be clear to the people doing the work. So that's all how a team works. A team should work very well together in communication from top to bottom, and that creates success. So what Mike's doing right now is he's spraying a little water on the surface. Remember, this is a dry polymer cement, and it can be sticky. And so what we want, whoops, what we want is we don't need a perfect finish on this surface. What we need is the product to be 1/4 inch consistently on the edges of the joints, so that when we stamp this and stand on it, the texture is able to create that embossment, right? On the edges, on the joints. So what I was saying, if you have a breeze coming in from the east, and you know this edge is going to catch that breeze, you would want to take what's called a skin and go over there and just wrap it. Now, if you can see this stamp right here, this is what's called a skin. It's a large skin. It's a stamp, right? And so this is a Roman slate? Yeah? Yeah, Roman slate pattern. It's honestly, in my opinion, the most popular stamp for concrete is Roman slate. There are literally hundreds of different patterns that you can use on stamped concrete. But I will tell you this, go with the most popular. If you're going to invest, they're not cheap. This is actually a Proline tool. I've been using Proline tools for many, many years. Brickform, Schofield, Matcrete. There's a lot of different stamp manufacturers. So say you're going to buy a set of stamps. If I am going to be in the stamp overlay or stamp concrete business, specifically speaking to overlays, I'm probably going to buy 8 of these. Say 5 foot by 5 foot. I'm going to buy 8 of these skins right here, the big boys. I'm also going to buy, say, 3 or 4 2 foot by 2 foot skins. And then I'm going to buy some that have floppies. And I'm going to buy some that are really flexible and floppy so I can stamp around posts. You can cut them. You can put them up under walls and stucco screed. And those are some of the tricks of the trade. So pro tip, buy enough stamps. And if you need to cut them or manipulate them, do it. You'll get better results. Remember, we don't have to have a perfect finish. And you can see this, it's just the product is down. I want to get back to what Mike was doing with that spray bottle. It was water. It was not a release at this point. What we needed was for the product to be trowelable, right? And so it's a sticky product. It's not like concrete where these guys can really finish it nice. So you missed on a little bit of water, but not too much. And yes, it needs to be consistently sprayed. You shouldn't spray water over in one area, and then this one, now we don't need the water. It's still real wet. Remember what I was saying about putting water on these modified cements that have integral color to them? It could change or lighten or whiten some of the cements. Now, then we have dry times. What we are looking for is a stampable product. And so when is that? What is that? It really depends on the elements of weather. So we need to be very keen as to what this is, what kind of day it's going to be. On cool days that are overcast, say we're down by the beach. It could take 3 hours, 4 hours. I've seen it take 5 hours. In some cases, I've seen it take more than that. In a lot of cases, I think the most common, when it's normal weather temperatures and we lay the stamp over it, TC6 down or quarter of an inch, it's typically between, you know, 30 minutes and an hour and a half, somewhere in there, hour and a half on the long side. What I strongly recommend is on every particular job, whether it's your team or yourself, is you have one chief that's eyeballing what you stamped. And that if we're doing a couple thousand square feet, we know our layout, my stamps and my release are all up there and I'm ready to attack, but I'm not sure what my timing is. We look for reflection. I'm always watching the reflection, the reflective value of the product that's curing. Is there still water on it? Or is the water kind of gone? Okay, I'm closer to it. I need to go touch it. So I'm going to scurry over there and I'm actually going to put my hands on the surface. So just fundamentally speaking, what I'm looking for is being able to push my hand on the surface, not have anything stick. I don't need any material sticking to my hand and I can leave an impression. So now remember, because this product, when it's ready to stamp, needs to be embossable or stampable, soft enough to leave an impression of this stamp, whatever it is, but it needs to be able to hold me. It needs to be able to hold my weight, okay? And that's what I'm looking for. So I might run over and check the areas that I started stamping 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, 5 times. We're not ready. Or you know what? The edge is drying. Okay, I need to throw me some skins. I'm gonna release the skin, release the product, and just do the edge. So they have texture on the edges or a challenging area. Or there was an area where the sun was shining through. Yes, I'm paying attention to this. So keeping all this in mind, I know it's a lot to think about, but these are how you get the best results. So Mike's telling me this is going to be a little while, and it's the nature of the beast. We're going to keep an eye on it. Exactly what I'm telling you is a critical aspect to the application of Stamp It system is keeping an eye on it. So what we're going to do is Todd is helping and our director and bringing over a stamp system that is already done. And I'm going to speak to the system because we have a bubblegum release. It's our release agent. And we're going to physically show you when we stamp this, when it's ready, you release the stamp and then you release the product. One of the questions we get frequently is how often do you release the stamp and release the product? And there's a big variable there. Do you have to release the tool, the stamp, every time you pick it up? The answer is no. When it's hotter, most likely you will. You need to actually look at it. So we would be in the field, pick up stamps, and they're so big sometimes. You pick them up like this, I'd show my partner and be like, do I need more release? And he says, yeah. Or he says, no, it's dry. Or vice versa. And so then he would spray the thing with release before I put it on the surface. We always spray the stamp, spray the surface. I want to speak to expansion joints. This is a little bit different system in that we are going to bridge the expansion joints in concrete as we lay this down, a quarter of an inch thick cement. But we will not leave them bridging expansion joints. They would fracture quickly. So we honor them, but we do it in a different way than the texturecrete systems, than the SRR finish that we covered and the wood plank that we covered. There's several different ways to honor joints. The way that I prefer doing them is to honor them as you go by means of like the edge of my trowel. And I will physically show you. Grab me a trowel, Mike. That'd be great. So usually, right before I do a project, thank you. So say that's a wall and this is outside or across the driveway or wherever there might be an expansion joint. I notice that and I'll take a pencil or a keel and I will mark the wall, a little crow's foot, or a mark, right? A crow's foot, for anybody that doesn't know, is a mark that is pointed, right? So it has a very specific arrow to it, chink, chink, like an arrowhead. And so I'd mark the wall where the start of the joint is here, and then I'd come down and I'd make another mark on this side. So now that I know, and I need to be sure that my joint's straight, God forbid the concrete expansion unit is not straight, make sure it's straight before you do that. And then you can trowel directly over this joint with the gauge rake and the TC6 cement, and you can leave it, and you're gonna come back and you're going to incise it or cut it afterwards. Or what I always made a habit of doing is as we're putting down this TC6 stamp it system, gauge raking, I knew there was a joint here, and I would, there it is right there. And I'd take the edge of my trowel and I just go, okay, good, keep going. And we stay in production. It's that fast, it's that easy. Now I know where my joint is, and I'm just burying my trowel into the joint. So it's always revealed. Yes, it's covered. I haven't cleaned it up yet. We will do that before we stain, right? So, but now I know where my joint is. So that's one of the simplest ways. The other ways, we used to take 8-penny nails and we tap them into a joint here, tap them into the side of the joint here, and then we do the whole stamp overlay. We come back the next day, and now we have dried stamp overlay with either a line through it from the edge of my trowel or the marking, the crow's foot, or the 8-penny nails in the joint. And now my prep for the stain and the sealer is cutting open the joints, and I need to typically chalk them, right? Use white chalk, snap a line between two nails or two marks. If I took my trowel into this, they're already marked. So all I need to do is take my crack chaser diamond blade, and I would usually use like a 6-foot or 8-foot 1x4 pine. Make sure that edge is nice and straight, and I'd put it right next to where I need to cut, and I would measure it, and I would just drive this crack chaser diamond blade directly into the joint as deep as it will allow. It's typically a 1/2 inch, somewhere in there, and you open it up. But I only do that to joints, right? And then I make sure that there's nothing feeble about the application, nothing that's gonna break away. But we honor all joints, and so you will need to do that before staining, every time before staining. Now, the bubblegum release that we use is release. So there is, it's a solvent release. So there's a part of the release, the solvent aspect is going to disappear as it is exposed to the atmosphere. So, but it doesn't mean that you don't have to rinse the surface. You need to rinse the surface typically with a mild dish soap like Dawn degreaser, or a degreasing agent, but almost all degreasing products need to be diluted with water. But you do need to rinse it because there is a slight amount of release agent that's still on top of the surface here. So the way that we do that is like a 5-gallon pail of water and Dawn dish soap or some degreaser that's diluted, pour it on the surface and you broom it around. Agitate the surface, rinse it off. Once it's completely rinsed, it doesn't have to be 100% dry before you put water-based stain on it. And that's what Mike's gonna do now. We have a sample that is hard. We did this yesterday, and it is rinsed, and it is dry, and so it's ready to go. So Mike, it's all yours. He's gonna pre-wet this with water. And again, one of the really nice things about water-based stain is there's so many different ways to do it. I really like the habit of working with two colors more than, and it's been the most popular, more than working with three colors. Beyond three colors, it can become kind of a mush. I think working with two colors is the best results, especially in production work. Water-based stain is not reactive. This is not an acidic stain. It is not going to react like acid stains would, and acid stains need 4 to 6 hours. Can you use acid stain on the stamp overlay? Absolutely, you can. Read the specs on acid stain or call your rep. So he put down water first and then just sprayed on the water-based stain. Now, this could be broomed or leave it alone. I would prefer to just leave it alone. Why? Because it finds the texture. You can actually see this. Good job, Mike. It really finds the texture in the lows. You can see where it's the water, the pre-wetting this surface, when the stain hit it, allows for the stain to find the depth. It's running to the low areas, right? So you can do this, you can back off, you can reapply a second application if you want deeper looking texture. And that's all done with SC35, water-based stain. The SC35 can be diluted with water. Obviously, we put it right on top of water. You can pre-wet and then put stain. You can put water in the stain, or you can put the stain down and then add water over the top. Remember, I do not recommend rolling. If you're gonna apply stain in production, use a big 24-inch push broom, silver bristle push broom, like a giant paintbrush, and you'll be amazed at your results. It really is a user-friendly product, number one, but you're able to apply it quickly, which is great. And when it's dry, it can be sealed. Okay, so we have a board. We're gonna put some sealer on it. We're gonna use the SC65 gloss. Most of the time, I'm gonna do, or I'm gonna suggest an application of, say, SC70, which is a single component acrylic lacquer. The beauty of this is it pops the color and it dries fast. The single component acrylic lacquer smells, and that's why we're not doing it inside here. So we don't wanna have our team pass out. So we are going to mix up the SC65. It's a two component product. We already mixed up the flat. Now this is the SC65G. So this is our gloss. The stamp overlays look great with a gloss finish on them. Water-based sealers have reached way beyond expectations. They're performing extremely well over the last 10 years. I recommend them frequently on your projects, and they're UV stable, so exterior, interior. But remember, when putting high gloss polyurethanes, and for that matter, even the satin or the flat, on exterior surfaces, these surfaces may become slippery. And so that being said, there's ways of creating non-skid surfaces or anti-skid surfaces. We have a product called Safe Grip. Safe Grip is anti-skid beads. You can see it here. I'm just kind of filtering it down. We have three different sizes. Our standard is CA30. It's a small Safe Grip, smaller than salt. We have a large CA31. And what this product is, CA29, it's a mini. You can use these with our sealers to create anti-skid surfaces. The CA30 is our standard Safe Grip, and I recommend it for anti-skid in your sealers. And Mike's got this on timer. Remember, the SC65G is our gloss, and yes, he mixed it for 3 minutes, three parts A, one part B. So there's a couple things. Let me grab me a trowel and water. So some of the little pro things to do is, so this is stiffening up. Now we're not quite prepared, or say, you know, the boss calls. Let me see. This is water?
That's water.
You know, in some cases, you can come back in here and slightly re-emulsify this surface. Now, as you can see, we put our hand on this and it's like, okay, it's not sticking. I could probably put my 220-pound body on this, but I needed a couple minutes. So a little bit of water, okay? A little bit of water topically, no puddles, no standing water. We'll slightly re-emulsify this, and you get out on this wherever you can reach or however you want to do, and you can bring this surface a little more life, right? And it gives us the ability to say, hey, partner, we ready to stamp. We got the release. We got everything we need. I got my trowels. I got my margin trowels. Because when you're using a pattern, say like a Roman Asher slate, you have a lot of pattern pinch marks, right? Where you pick up a stamp or two stamps come together, they'll have pinch marks. And you want to be able to take care of those as much as you possibly can while you go. Sometimes you got to go, and you're not going to have that luxury. So a little bit of water, trout over the surface. Gives you a couple more minutes of time. So let's get this going, right? Okay, so what Mike's doing is he has the release. It is a bubblegum release. We release the stamp, and then we release the product. Go ahead. So this aspect of tool needs to stay right with you, meaning we only release the product as we're going to lay down the stamp. We don't start releasing the whole product. Start spraying release everywhere. Don't do that. You release right before you lay a stamp. So we got a skin. He's going to lay it down. He's going to roll it into the product. Roll it, walk in it. Now, a stamp laid is the one you pay attention to. As you can imagine, man, we got 8 of these stamps, and oh my gosh, it's time to go. Chop, chop. We got to get rolling on this. We start having guys lay down stamps. Remember, one chief. One person that can orchestrate this assembly. So my pro tip is when you lay a stamp down, you pay attention to the texture that is supposed to provide you. There are pounders. Do we have a pounder? Okay. I don't have a pounder here. I'd show you what a pounder is. But a pounder is basically a flat base plate, typically 10 inches by 10 inches. And the way that you use pounders is you stand on the surface and keep your back straight so you don't have arthritis in your back like me. And you just pound straight down so that you don't get a bunch of boot prints. This, right? And you pound the surface. You pound every square inch of that stamp. Now we're ready to progress and lay the next stamp. And the next stamp, we would release the surface. We would take this mat, we would roll it just like you did, about, 6 to 8 inch overlap onto this stamp, and then you roll it into the surface. Then you immediately pick up this edge and put the other one down, and then a stamp laid is the one that you pay attention to, and you stamp this thing. So when you're using a pounder, you don't beat the living heck out of this thing to where, you're splitting off and have blowouts. You're just pounding the texture consistently, right? And so, yeah, in a lot of cases, you can do exactly what Mike's doing, especially with overlays, which is, it's different from concrete. It's an overlay. Remember, it's 1/4 inch thick. That's all we're working with here. So delicate, I guess, is the word that I would use, is be a little more delicate than you would concrete. So now, one thing you want to do is take a look at your texture before you remove the whole mat. Okay, so I don't know if you can see this on camera, but we pull this back and we go, oh, it looks great, hold on. It doesn't look so great right here. So he's standing on the mat. I don't know if you can see that, but roll it back down. This way, the mat, he didn't move off of the mat. He rolls it right back down in exactly where the texture was. So he doesn't get that bead right here repeating, a half inch away from where it was. So stand on the mat, take a look, and you'll be like, oh no, I need to get it back down again. Then you go, boom, boom, boom. Okay, that looks better. Okay. So that as you do it, so it's a careful process. Go ahead, Mike. And you're gonna roll it back, everything looks great. And roll it right off. You're gonna come in. Hey, do I need more release? I'm like, you're good to go. He's gonna, and the production value, gonna come back, and you're gonna stay in production. Your production line, again, needs to have been figured out prior. So that's your stamp. As you're working, however many stamps that you have is typically the working area that you and your team will be working on. So you got your tools, you got a couple skins, because the other aspect is if you pull up this big mat, one of the big ones, 5x5 or bigger, if you're working on bigger with bigger tools, you pull it up and you're already carrying it away. And someone says, hey man, there's a little area that didn't get texture. I really don't want to take this big mat and throw it back down there. I'm going to go get the skin. So we would always typically have one guy on detail, meaning every time we pick up a mat before we move our platform of mats away from that area, he's going to take one of the smaller skins with a texture on it, throw it back down right on that surface, get a texture on that surface, and move with us. Okay, so back on the sealer, the SC65 gloss. Go ahead, Mike. One of the beautiful things about the SC65, the G, the SC65SG, and the SC65F, it is an incredible quality product. So you have these qualities and durabilities, chemical resistant, mar resistance of an aliphatic polyurethane, but there's no smell. Like anybody that's been doing this for a long time, you've smelled the solvenated polyurethanes that was really all we had available to us over the years. There's no smell to this. So whether it be a production job, you can make solid positive points to using these products, specifically in the state of California. I mean, California, where we manufacture, it's the toughest VOC state in the country. So VOC, volatile organic compound. So polyurethane, to be redundant, it goes on very, very thin to win. And can it be sprayed? Yes. Airless sprayer. Mike made a good point when I was speaking to this earlier, is the SC65, when it's not thinned, remember, when it's used neat, doesn't spray very well. It's problematic because it's heavier body. I don't know if you saw it when he poured it out, little like pancake syrup consistency, right? So neat through an airless is okay. If you thin it out, it can spray as well, but we're using it not thinned. So that is the stamp overlay system. I am going to give this right back to Mallory, and she's going to finish up and give it right back to me, and I will close this out quickly and get you guys on your way.
Hi everyone, just wanted to thank you one more time for joining us today. We did just want to jump back onto the website real quick. So I know that Mark had talked about the TC30 at one point. That is our slope mix. I just want to show you where to find the spec sheet for that in case you missed it earlier. Under resources here, there is our spec sheets tab on the left-hand side. And if you scroll down, you will see that under the waterproof section, there's actually a slope technique spec sheet here. So that's actually the entire process of how to do the slope. Underneath the TC section is where you'll actually find the TC30 slope mix spec for just the material itself. So there are two kind of different ways to find that information. So just kind of wanted to point that out and make sure you had that. If you are not already enrolled in our QCA or Qualified Contractor Applicator Program and you are interested in that, on the website, again on this homepage here, if you scroll down, you will see the QCA benefits and you can click Apply Today. There's an application to fill out. There are some requirements to be a QCA. If you are a QCA, you all will be approved in the category of system that you install. Being a QCA means that you will get leads from Westcoat, and you're also entitled to project-specific warranties. So if you do need a warranty for your actual project, we can provide that to you. And then we also have co-op and rebate a program as well. So if you were to sign up for this program, we do quarterly or yearly rebates, and there's definitely a lot of information that you can gain. We get we help with marketing, and so yeah, there's a lot of benefits for that QCA program. One last thing I did want to share with the team is that we do have a lot of different resources for you. So along with the website, you'll see here that we actually do have, and I know Mark spoke about this as well, we have printed color charts that you can use for your customers and your clients. So all of the systems and finishes we talked about today, we've got those. The brochures that I showed earlier on the website, we do have all of those printed out as well. So you can request those from us and we can send those out to you. And then Mark had also showed that we have a good amount of samples that we can send out as well. So this is something that we are happy to provide. Like Mark said, these are free for you. And we will go ahead and pass it off to Mark real quick right now to just say goodbye.
Thanks for taking the time. This will be available to watch video for anybody later, but that behind the scenes, everybody that can't see, I mean, Victoria, Amanda, Mallory, and Todd Cook, they make my job really easy. So, and they're all a part of, they're all actual human beings that are, you can reach out to. And if I'm your rep, then reach out to me. So thank you, everybody. Really appreciate it.